Thanks everyone for coming to this talk on building analog displays. Before we get started, I was curious, how many people here have done any kind of electronics projects before? Raise your hand. Oh, a lot of people. Wow, this might be basic for you guys. And how many people here have always wanted to do something but haven't had the time or a chance? Okay, awesome. So why build these kinds of displays? Well, you know, I think they're really fun. They're fun to play with and interact with, but they're also really fun to build. You know, it can be kind of challenging, but it's this cool mix of merging, you know, software with the physical world and dealing with the constraints that you see in the physical world and a lot of these devices. They can be really engaging. So if you have something on your desk or in your apartment, someone walks by, I think chances are pretty good they'll stop and take a look and ask questions. I want to know more about it and want to understand how it works. I really love how they become part of your environment. So it can be kind of in the background, but maybe you'll notice something out of the corner of your eye or your peripheral vision. And you can look at it then and interact with it. But then when you're done, it kind of fades in the background. It doesn't have to always be kind of, you know, in your face and on all the time. You can learn surprising things, both about your data by looking in a different way, but also, you know, maybe the way you thought something would turn out didn't turn that way, but the project becomes good for displaying something else. You know, a lot of ways to learn. Use other senses, so not just sight, but also sound. I guess you could use touch and smell, but that might be kind of creepy. And I'm a big believer that constraints drive creativity. You know, I think when you deal with the constraints, it forces you to think in a different way and, you know, try things you wouldn't normally try. And that can carry over into other parts of your life, which is really cool. And certainly with the kinds of devices we're talking about, there are a lot of constraints. But also just the physical world in general, there are a lot of constraints. If you saw Joe Armstrong's talk this morning, he mentioned some of those. So my goals for this talk, really I want to inspire you to create your own displays, and a big part of that I think is trying to convince you that it's easy, and I want to give you a starting point. There's, you know, a ton you can do here. A lot of the stuff I'm going to go over is kind of introductory, and it should seem easy, and that's, you know, intentional. But like with anything, I think once you have a good grasp of the basics, it's easy to kind of build on incrementally and go further and further and further. And a lot of it just kind of knowing what to Google for, right? So hopefully we get there. So kind of a loose agenda, talk about a couple different hardware platforms, cover some specific display projects that I've worked on, and then if we have time, kind of there's a next step section. So the platforms I want to cover are the Arduino, the SparkCore, and the Raspberry Pi. But first, let's talk about microcontrollers. So what is a microcontroller? Well, you can think about it like it's a really tiny computer where everything is integrated into a single package. So the processing, the storage, memory, input and output are all in a single package. So this is a picture of a bunch of microcontrollers. You can see they have these little legs, or pins, the silver things coming out of the package, and that's how you power it, that's how you program it, that's how you, you know, read and write input to it. Typically pretty constrained, anywhere from bytes. This one has, I think, 64 bytes of RAM available to you. You know, it's not too hard to get a couple K, but we're talking that kind of range. And, you know, there's a big range. You know, they run from single-digit megahertz, you know, and up. They don't really have an operating system, right? The program you write is the only thing that's running on the chip. The upside is they're really cheap and really small. So this one is, you know, smaller than a dime, and they get even smaller. The only reason it's this big is because it's easy to work with. You know, they make really tiny ones, but they're hard to work with. Unless you have really great eyesight, I guess. And this one costs about 55 cents if you're buying a bunch of them. And you know, it goes from there, right? Maybe a couple bucks. And they're everywhere. There's way more microcontrollers out there than there are computers. You know, a typical modern car probably has a couple dozen of these easy in it. Even like a fancy coffee machine probably has, you know, one or two microcontrollers in them. So the first platform I'm gonna talk about is Arduino. How many people here have heard of Arduino before? Wow, everybody. How many people here have an Arduino? Okay, wow, a lot of people. So you guys know about this, but I'll cover a couple things. So if you haven't heard, which is, it seems like nobody, it's a really awesome platform. So it's like a microcontroller development kit. But more than that, it's really just a platform for making, you know, cool interactive things. I think it was really designed with non-programmers in mind, actually, which I think is why there's a lot of things they spent trying to make it easy to use. But you can see that kind of large, rectangle underneath the Arduino, that's the microcontroller. And then at the top and the bottom, there are these, you know, black slots They're numbered, and those break out the pins from the microcontroller. So you can stick an LED in there or a wire or something, and that connects to the microcontroller. The cool thing about Arduino, right, is that it has this whole ecosystem of an ID and tool chain. It's all open source and cross-platform. Even the hardware itself is open source, so you can download the schematic and the parts list and build one of these yourself. Great community, tons of example codes. If you search for like Arduino anything, you'll find someone that's done something before and you can build off of. It has built-in USB for doing power and programming it, and also communication if you want. You can also power it externally. So once you program it, it doesn't need to be connected to the computer. It's a standalone thing, right? But you can have it connected to the computer if you want to be able to, you know, talk to it and interact with it. So the Hello World program for hardware is blinking LED. A lot more fun, I think, and really pretty cool. The first time, I remember still the first time I blinked an LED with an Arduino, and I was so excited, I yelled across the apartment for my wife to come check it out. She came over and was not as impressed. But you know, for me, it was a really big point, and looking back on it, I think it, you know, it makes sense, right? It's like once you get to this point, it's like a Hello World program for when you're learning a new programming language. You know, to get to that point, it's a simple thing, but it means you have the whole tool chain working, you have any compilation working, you have the runtime working, and you still got a long way to go, but there's a lot of stuff you can do incrementally to kind of build on top of it, right? So with an LED, okay, you're blinking the LED, but it's not blinking, you're telling it to blink. And building on top of that is pretty easy, right? Sometimes you're just blinking like this, maybe you change how often it's blinking, maybe instead of blinking you do fading, maybe you try and replicate like the Apple like sleeping LED effect. And then from there, it's really just another incremental step to get it to blink when new email comes in or when there's a new tweet, or to get it to change intensity depending on, you know, how well you're doing with your Fitbit tracking or whatever. Those are all just incremental steps on top of blinking LED. So everyone, if you haven't yet, blink an LED and then come see me and I'll give you a high five. It's all downhill from here. So how do you blink an LED on Arduino? Well, it's pretty easy. I mean, so with Arduino, you're really targeting, it's like C, C++, but they try and simplify it a little bit with their tools and IDE. So it's a little bit almost scripty on top of that. There's kind of two parts of the event loop. So there's a setup function that runs one time when the Arduino starts up, and then a loop that runs over and over again. And so the pins in Arduino can be used for input and output. So we need to tell it, okay, set the mode for this pin to output, and then we just write high, which turns it on, wait a second, right low, turns it off, wait a second, and then we're blinking. I just wanted to point out real quick that, you know, the IDE has a ton of built-in examples, including blink and more complex stuff. It's, you know, check it out. So communication, the Arduino has built-in USB serial. Ethernet, Wi-Fi, and Bluetooth are possible, but kind of expensive. We're talking like 30, 40, 50 bucks to add that to an Arduino. I think there's another platform that'll be better suited if you know you want to do Wi-Fi and you know you want it to be completely standalone. But I think the Arduino is still an awesome platform for prototyping and debugging, and super easy to get started with. And then it's kind of pretty easy to translate it from the Arduino to another platform, and we'll go through some of those examples later, but it's a great place to get started. So we'll talk about Fermata, which is a generic protocol for communicating with microcontrollers. So we have that serial connection going over USB through the Arduino, and we want to be able to talk to it from the computer and maybe read from it from the computer. So how do you do that? Well, you can do your own stuff. It's not that hard to read and write serial, but you may eventually want to do more complex things. And so there's already a protocol out there you can use. You just load basically a generic program on the Arduino, and then there's client libraries available that know how to speak this protocol. It makes it really easy to create what I call kind of dumb devices, where all the logic is happening on the computer, all the processing happening on the computer, and you're literally just telling the Arduino, okay, turn on pin 13, turn off pin 13, you know, read a value, write a value. It makes it really easy. Great for prototyping. It's really reduced the amount of time it takes me to take something from idea to have something working. So here's what it looks like. This is the Python library for it. And you can see I just connect to the Arduino and give it the path to the serial port. And I just need to say, you know, get this pin. And there's a little code here. So D means digital, 13 is pin 13. And O means I want to use it for output. And then basically the same thing as before, right? You know, we write 1, which is high, sleep. Write 0, which is low, sleep. But the difference here is that the computer is telling the Arduino to turn the LED on and off. And the Arduino is just, you know, listening to what it says. Whereas the other example, all the logic was happening on Arduino. So now you know, quick recap, how to blink an LED on Arduino, and how to make a computer tell the Arduino to blink an LED. So go out and make a display. This is all you need to know. And I hope you can see that, like the last example, we can hook that up to anything, right? Hooking it up to your Gmail feed, to Twitter, anything, and super easy to do at that point, because you're all doing it just all on the computer side and just pushing that into the Arduino. So this next platform I want to talk about is called the SparkWhir, and it's kind of a newer thing. It was on Kickstarter a while back, and I haven't played around with it too much, but it's just really, really cool, and so I wanted to share it. It's kind of Arduino-ish. They try and, I think, making the runtime and everything as much like Arduino as possible, much beefier chip. So the Arduino, I don't think I mentioned, has 2K of RAM, which is pretty decent. This has 20K of RAM, so 10X. A lot more power. But the really cool thing about this is it has built-in Wi-Fi. So this costs about $40. The Arduino is $25. It's built-in Wi-Fi. And not just the hardware, but they also build this kind of infrastructure on their side to be able to put your device behind an API. So by default, when your device starts up, connects to the network, it'll kind of phone home, see if there's any instructions. And the cool thing with that is you have this whole API in front of your thing. We'll go through some of those examples. Here's the LED example, basically the same exact code as the Arduino. You notice this is in like a web IDE they have, and if you click that flash icon, it'll compile the code on their server and then push it down to your SparkWhir over the internet, which is pretty cool. There's a similar thing they have to the Fermata. They call it Tinker, but it's the same idea where when you first get your core, it has kind of a generic program on it that knows how to look for input, and you can control the pins manually, like turn this on or off or read values. They even have an iPhone and Android app that just uses the API. This is what I think is the really cool part. So this is the API, right? So you have your device ID, which maps to your device, and calling digital write, I pass in my access key, and then the parameters, I want digital pin 7, I want to turn it high. And so I make this call using curl or whatever over the internet, and my device will know to turn its LED on also over the internet, just pure Wi-Fi communication. What's even cooler is you can do more than that, right? Because the SparkWhir, like the Arduino, can do processing on its own end. So if I want to, you know, bind a new method, so I'm here binding this brew coffee method to like the string brew. So when an HTTP request comes in and matches brew, it's going to call my method with any arguments. I can do some processing and return values, and the caller will get these values back. And so this is a kind of really cool way, I think, where you can mix. There's, you know, processing and logic happening on the device, and maybe it's not just in response to the input, but maybe there's other things that you're looking at. Maybe the device knows, you know, if it's dark outside or not, or what the temperature is, and this other system somewhere else knows about something else. And you can combine all these things really easily. There's also a bunch of stuff for having these things communicate to each other. They have a whole like kind of publish subscribe mechanism, and you can also just connect, you know, to an IP address, you know, straight from the device. You don't need to go through their API and everything like that, but. Anyway, I think it's really cool. If you know for sure you want to do Wi-Fi and you want it to be really standalone, this is the way to go. Oh, here's calling the method. So it's call slash brew, like you'd expect, and I get the return value they'd expect. So it's really, really cool. So Raspberry Pi. So I think everyone here knows what Raspberry Pi is, probably. So the reason I'm including this, it seems pretty different, and it is pretty different, but it's similar price point, right? So we're talking $40. And the other thing is it has general purpose I/O pins, or GPIO. So you see in the bottom right, there's a bunch of copper pins. And just like an Arduino or SparkWhir, I can read and write, you know, values to those pins. The cool thing about the Raspberry Pi, right, is that it's like a real computer. It has 512 megs of RAM, which is just insane when you're comparing it to like 20K or 2K. I don't know, who would ever need 512 megabytes of RAM? It's just gluttonous. But you got it in case you really need it. But the other cool thing is it's a real computer with a real OS, right? So it's running Linux, have multi-user support, can run multiple programs at a time. And the really cool thing about that is you have device drivers. So you can go on Amazon and buy like a $10 Wi-Fi adapter, plug in a USB, and now you have Wi-Fi, right? You cannot do that with these other platforms because they're not computers. Plus you've got Ethernet, video, and audio and all that stuff. So of course, with the Raspberry Pi, we can also make an LED blink. Pretty easy. You just hook up, you know, some wires to the pins, hook up to an LED. Here's some code. So I think Raspbian comes with this RPy package, and you know, different details, but same structure. We need to set the pin for output, and then we're writing true, which is high, and then false, which is low, and we're blinking LED. Pretty easy. Okay, so let's talk displays. So the first thing I think a lot of people make, or that I made, was this kind of view meter style display, which I really like. I think it has a great classic look. It'll look good in any living room. It's pretty easy to do. You know, one kind of disappointment with this, when I pictured it in my mind, I was picturing these like really wildly swinging meters, like you'd have in a stereo or something like that. But then I hooked it up to Amazon CloudWatch, which is this like AWS metric service, and the max granularity you have there is a minute. So it only moves every minute. So not as exciting, but still pretty cool. And I think you still can really kind of notice big swings when they happen, to know if something is wrong or different. And even across the room, you can kind of just really quickly visually see if it's all the way on one side or the other, like something is not right, right? The hardest part about this project was like finding this really old labeling tape. Otherwise, you just get some displays, which is a key effect. I think if you want to take it further, you can put a custom faceplate in, which would have been nice. I was too lazy to do that. All you really need is the meter, some wire, and you know, an Arduino or something like that, and that's it. One thing I'll mention, if you do want to do this with the other things, Raspberry Pi and SparkCore, and we'll go through some examples of what the code looks like on that end, you just need to get different meters. This is 0 to 5 volts, which is what the Arduino outputs. The other two do 3.3 volts, but it's not a big deal. You just need, don't buy this specific meter. So here's what some Python code looks like. So this is assuming we're running the Fermata sketch on our Arduino, and the rest we're just doing in Python, right? So I connect to the Arduino like we did before. Then I have some code to connect to CloudWatch to pull the metrics. It's basically the full code. I cheated a little bit in the get metric statistics function and took out two date parameters just because they were kind of long calculating like the time frame I wanted. But otherwise, this is the full code that runs. One thing maybe you'll notice that's different about this is in the get pin, so I say digital pin 5 and then P instead of O. So what does P mean? Well, P stands for PWM. And what does PWM stand for? Stands for pulse width modulation. And what it is you can kind of think about it as if you had like a light switch for a room and you turned it on and off really, really fast. At some point, hopefully it'd be fast enough where your eyes would kind of blind together the two states and it would look brighter than a dark room and not as bright as a light room. It should be in the middle. And so PWM is a technique for taking a digital signal and simulating an analog signal. And if you vary how long you spend in the on state and the off state, you can change the intensity. So this is how you blink an LED, or fade an LED, or like dim an LED, or with the meters, this is how you write more than just on and off, right? And you don't need to know a lot of these details. You just need to know that you want to use PWM, and the different platforms have a different way to express the intensity. Like on the Arduino, it's between 0 and 255, but with the Fermata library, I think it's between 0 and 1. So the details will change a little bit, but the idea is the same, right? It's just a way to simulate a kind of analog signal with different values. So here's that same example, but on the Raspberry Pi. Basically, the exact same code. Since it's still Python, it's nothing really changed except how we interact with the device. The PWM is a little more complicated here to set it up, but otherwise the same. And just to round it out, here's an example with the SparkCore using their API over the web. This is using Fitbit instead of CloudWatch because I wanted to change it up, or RunKeeper. I'm looking at my total miles run the last week, which is 0, but hopefully that's going up. Okay, so this next one is a receipt printer for exceptions. So it's yeah, so everyone loves this display. So it takes application exceptions and prints them on a receipt printer. And it was a really fun project, and yes, everyone seems to love it, which is awesome. You know, when I was thinking about it, I was kind of picturing in my mind almost like a short order cook where a receipt would come out, you could tear it off, put it on your coworker's desk, maybe have like a ticket number on it, you know, fix this. But and I thought it'd be kind of a joke, and it is kind of a joke, but at the same time, it actually was kind of interesting in ways that I didn't expect. You know, first of all, these printers are really, really, really noisy. And so you'll hear across the room that, like, wow, something's happening, and how often it's happening. And the other thing is the paper trail, if you don't care about wasting paper, becomes a really great indicator of the system health. If you go out to lunch and you come back and your desk is covered in a mess of paper like this, then before you even sit down or log on your computer, you know something is not right. And you know, if you come back and your desk looks clean, well, maybe you have time to grab a coffee or something before you sit down. So I think, you know, it was fun, and also, like I said, I think I learned some things about, you know, future experiments for, you know, just thinking about length and visual length as something for, you know, information you need to look at, was really kind of cool. It's pretty easy to do. So this receipt printer, there's like a library for the Arduino to talk to it. That was easy. I just really had to come up with like a little bit of a protocol for just how do I format the message so I can format it differently on the printer. But otherwise, it's really not that hard compared to blinking LED. So this is, I always want to do something with sound. And this is like a kid xylophone I got off Amazon. And then I mounted a bunch of solenoids, which are like a linear motor, underneath it, which is not how you play a xylophone, but was easier to do. And I think I have a video. See if the sound works. Yeah, so this was a really, really fun project to build. I even, like, you notice there's like a purple board on top of the Arduino. So I designed my own circuit board for this just because I want something a little more permanent. It was pretty easy to do. I mean, you know, it took some time and planning, and I had to learn a bunch of things about solenoids and how to drive them. But again, you're just sending signals. It turned out to be kind of annoying in practice. You know, the idea was events come in, like a tweet or an email or something or an alert, and it'll play a different song or different melody. I didn't really like that, but the thing is, it was fun to play as like a piano. So I ended up writing a program where you could kind of play it like a keyboard, record a song, and it'll play it back for you kind of thing. And I took it to this Maker Faire event, and kids really loved it. They loved, like, not just playing a song, but then recording it and giving it a name and playing it back. So I think, even though I think as a display, it wasn't super successful, I think it was still a fun project and good for something else. Okay, so this one, not as exciting, but I found these cool electronic counters in like a surplus store. And it's kind of like, if you think about like a really old alarm clock or like in a train station, like the old departure boards where the numbers kind of flip and make a loud noise. So this is like those. The one thing is these only go up. They don't go down. So they're kind of not super useful for any metric that doesn't only go up all the time. So you can never do like how many miles around this week, be like how many ever since this date. I guess you could do like the Unix epoch. I guess you could monitor this way. But anyway, the one thing with this is it turned out to be not really useful for display. But just like a lot of the other things, these make a really awesome sound. This is like clicking, very authoritative clicking, buzzing sound. And so, you know, while the numbers weren't very meaningful, it was easy to tell like the rate of change, how quickly things were changing, how slowly things were changing. And so that was kind of cool. Okay, so that's all I have. Well, I've done more, but not as interesting. But I've been thinking about some new things. I want to do something with an LED grid, RGB LED grid. I tried doing something to kind of display different applications we have running. But then it didn't really work out because there were just too many, and then the key became really confusing. Like, what color is what application? It's hard to remember all that stuff. So I was thinking maybe I could do something with like maybe GitHub commit activity would be good. They already kind of model it in this way in software anyway, so it'd be pretty easy to translate. Or maybe, you know, fitness activity or intensity, maybe some kind of heat map, or maybe some kind of crude graph. So maybe you'll see something soon on my blog. I don't know. This is also not mine. I don't know if you can see the numbers so great through the Etch-a-Sketch, but someone made... Yeah, so I always wanted to do a drawing robot too. You know, in my mind, I pictured kind of like a whiteboard in a conference room or something like that, and kind of a robot with like a marker drawing like a graph live. I think it'd be really sweet. Seemed a little complicated, so of course I Googled Arduino Etch-a-Sketch and found this. So someone made a clock So every minute, it'll draw the time. The really cool thing about this design is it has this mechanism built in where it'll auto-erase itself. It'll like flip and erase, which is really sweet. Probably do something there. OK, so next steps. This is your homework. Get an Arduino and blink an LED. So quick shopping list. I hate to be commercial about this kind of thing, but it's like the problem with physical goods is that they need to be manufactured, and so it costs money. So buy an Arduino, spark core, whatever. Get a breadboard. So the background picture is a breadboard. It's basically a hunk of plastic with a bunch of slots in it that are connected together in a certain configuration. So you can connect components together without soldering or without them really being physically, you know, together. Must have for prototyping and developing. All of the displays I showed, all of those started out in a breadboard. And then you want some wire to connect things together. Get some LEDs. LEDs are cheap. Get a bunch of LEDs, different colors. Get some RGB LEDs. Get some meters if you like meters. I love meters. Buttons are fun just if you want some kind of input or controls. And then sensors. So I was talking mostly about output. But the really cool thing about microcontrollers, right, is they can also listen for input. And a lot of these sensors are really cheap, like temperature sensors, light sensors, humidity sensors, tilt sensors. You could these even like kind of sonar type distance sensors, a little more money, but those can become really cool. And then you can mix the things together, right? So the microcontroller can make decisions based on what it's sensing and what you're telling it from external data. So maybe it does different things if it's light versus if it's dark or whatever. Resistors, you always need resistors. Try and get a bunch of mixed ones. And then you don't really need a multimeter, but if you're going further, maybe you will. A multimeter is a tool that lets you measure voltage and current. And so if you're trying to debug things, like why isn't this working or why isn't this lighting up, it can be useful. And you can get a cheap one from Radio Shack for like 15 bucks. That's, you know, fine. So where do you get this stuff? You can get some stuff from Radio Shack. They don't have a ton of great stuff. So Adafruit is really awesome. They have a bunch of like project kits and parts. I can get those meters you can get from there. They have that receipt printer you can get from there. The really cool thing about them, too, is everything they sell, it's not just like, here's this thing. They have example code and tutorials and Arduino libraries. So it's really awesome. SparkFun, kind of similar, a little less documentation. Evil Mad Scientist, they got a bunch of cool like LED kits and drawing robots, and they're really cool people. Mauser is more like a typical electronics like warehouse store. Like if you know exactly what you want and you want to buy like 1,000 of them, it's probably your cheapest bet. So we didn't talk about soldering, and so you do not need to solder. None of the examples I showed require any soldering. You can do them all on a breadboard. It's not a problem. But if you want to learn how to solder, it's also very easy. Google soldering is easy, and you'll find this comic, tell you exactly what you need to do. Like with anything, it just takes practice. But even your first go around, you should be able to get something usable. You might want to design your own PCBs, which I think is also really fun. You know, and it's basically just a way to, if you have a project that you want to make more permanent, you can basically translate the breadboard into a circuit board and get it printed. Then you need to solder the components to it, but then it's a kind of more permanent you know, thing that you have. In between breadboards and circuit boards, there's also this thing called protoboard, which is kind of like a breadboard, but that you solder to. The cool thing about PCB is that since you can make a lot of the connections on the board itself, you don't have to have a ton of wires going from place to place. It's a lot cleaner, and it's actually not that bad. So some software, Jita, I think that's how you pronounce it, KiCad and Eagle, the first two are open source and free. The last one's commercial. When I started out, almost all the examples were only for Eagle, so I started using that. But KiCad has become really popular lately and has a ton of good, if you go to YouTube, there's a ton of great tutorials on how to use it. If you want to manufacture PCBs, so if you're going to make 1,000 of them, that's one thing. But if you just want to get a couple, I can't recommend enough this company, Oshpark. Really, really awesome people, and they'll print a circuit board for you. I think it's like $5 a square inch. You get three copies of it in 2 weeks, which is really quick. That's one thing about circuit boards is you definitely want to prototype first, because if you think about like slow compile times, like 2 weeks is pretty bad. So you want your design to work the first time around. But it's really fun. I definitely recommend it. It's kind of cool. These CAD packages are really kind of archaic, though, so it takes a while to get used to. So I think that's it. I went through way faster than I thought I was going to. I hope I didn't forget anything. So this talk's available online. I think it'll be linked to with other Strange Loop talks. I hope you guys all leave here and go make a display. Who's going to make a display? Raise your hand. OK, that's pretty good. I'll say that's 30% coverage. When you do, email me. I want to see it and hear about it. And yep, that's it. So if there's any questions, I can take them. Or
Are there any ways to have analog meters other than just having a voltmeter with the duty cycle?
Yeah, sure. Well, so the question is, are there ways to have analog meters besides having a voltmeter with the duty cycle? So that's easy. There's also, probably the better meter to get would be something that measures like amperage, because it's a lot of them are, they measure like milliamps, so it's easy to produce in any kind of platform. But otherwise, you could do something. If you want to make like a huge meter, life size, you could just get some kind of motor, right? So you could get like a servo motor, which is kind of like a cheaper motor, or like a hobby car motor or something like that, and hook it up to an Arduino or something, and kind of just keep track of how far you've turned it, right? And so you can make a huge like Price is Right style thing if you want. I'm sorry, can you repeat the question? PWM, so pulse width modulation, yeah. So this is a good example of this. Yeah, so this is going through Fermata, but it's basically just using pulse width modulation. So and the same thing, if you directly on the Arduino, if you call analog write, you pass it a value between 0 and 255, and it automatically does it for you. Yep. No, no kind of filtering. Yeah, a lot of these microcontrollers have PWM functionality built into the microcontroller, and so you're really just it's handling everything for you.
Which one of those platforms is best if you're going to go battery powered?
Yeah, so battery power is tricky. The Arduino requires at least 5 volts, so you need something that produces at least 5 volts. The other ones, I don't know, honestly, how you power the Raspberry Pi. The spark core is like 3.3 volts. If you do something like the picture of the first microcontroller I showed you, if you want something really low power, like these ones can run, I think, at like a little over a volt. And then how much power are you drawing? Well, most of these platforms, I know the Arduino anyway, and this one, I don't know about Raspberry Pi, but have like a sleep mode or a low power mode. And so the thing you want to do, right, is turn it off as much as possible. And so maybe, and you can do that in a couple different ways. Most of the platforms have timers, so you can put it to sleep for some period of time and then wake up. And a lot of platforms also have you can shut down different parts of it. So you can shut down the more expensive parts and do things like, it's mostly asleep, but if a signal comes in on one of the pins, it'll wake up, and those kinds of things. So you basically want to keep it asleep as much as possible. I don't know. I made a little like LED name tag before that ran, used this chip, and can run for a couple days on like a coin cell battery, which could even do better. Someone told me there's a bug in my sleep because it should last for longer than that. But the other thing to think about maybe is solar. You power a lot of these off of solar, like not even a huge solar panel, potentially.
Yeah.
MicroPython? No, I haven't.
It's basically Python.
Okay, cool. Is it running like Arduino or something? Or? Okay, cool.
Yep. Do you deal at all with higher power systems for like driving? I don't know that the solid thing, higher power or something like that,
Yeah, nothing too high. So the xylophone, yeah, those things need like 25 volts, which is probably the highest I've done. Is that what you thinking of? You're thinking of like hundreds of.
Did you have a separate power supply? Like, how did you get the power?
Yeah, so I just had a separate power supply, so I powered it separately, and then, yeah, so I just powered it separately, and then was able to just, just control it with the Arduino. So the, you know, the Arduino 5 volts was just the control to, you know, the power of the other thing. Okay, well, thanks, everyone. Thanks for coming.